Good morning, family, and welcome to Online Church.
Good morning. Welcome to our house, the Lloyds. My name is Dave, if you don't know me, and this is my wife, Johanna. We're just really excited for you to join us with Online Church this morning. We've had an announcement this week from the government that we'll be moving in a few days to level 3. The news for church about that is, of course, that we'll be pretty much staying the same, and this format will continue for the next few weeks at least. We've been enjoying it here. I know that one of the things we enjoy is the chat function. If you haven't seen that, it should be on the right-hand side of your screen. When you first log into that, you'll need to create a name. And I know that I created a name for our family first, Lloyd, D and J. I thought that would cover us both. But when Johanna logged on, she decided she wanted to chat separately to me. And so she created the Better Lloyd family account. Which was hurtful to my feelings. The good thing about chatting though online is that you can chat during the service, which normally would be a little bit frowned upon if we were meeting in the same place and you started chatting to someone across the other side of the room while Lawrence was up the front talking. But you can do that. You can do that right now. Go on, chat away.
You'll also see under the video that there is a prayer request button. So if you need someone in the team to reach out to you and pray with you individually, please hit that button and give us a moment and we'll get hold of you so that we can support you the best way that we can.
The other thing that you should be doing is trying to keep connected during the week. It's not just a Sunday thing. Just like church normally, it's better. And as a church body, we function better when we stay connected during the week. So join in on those Zoom meetings or maybe just give someone a call. Chat through social media. I know that the worship team, we get together when we're normally practicing. Instead of that, we're in a Zoom meeting, making sure that we have the right things ready for you on a Sunday morning, but also just connecting and making sure that we have that time together.
There is also a Kāpiti Impact Church community Facebook page, which is a great and casual setting for us to connect during the week. You can post pictures, you can post some music you may have found, a short video of what you're doing, and it's a great way for us to keep in touch with each other. Dave and I have been really impressed with seeing some great community connection around us locally during this strange lockdown period. We've really enjoyed seeing daily cooking tutorials from Sunday Cantina. We've seen our very own Dan from Mr. Watts Electrical, who's participating in a $500 giveaway for an individual or a family in need. If you would like to nominate someone, you can head over to his Facebook page. And we've really loved seeing messages from individuals just reaching out to other vulnerable people in our community. Offering to share a meal or help them with their shopping or do something that they might be struggling with, even if it's just keeping those lonelies at bay during this strange time.
Yeah, it's going to be great. It's a need for us to keep being kind and keep doing this stuff, even as we come out of these lockdown periods. For now, let's head across to Philippa, and she's got something for us with Ignite Kids.
Mom, wake up. It's time for church.
I can tell you're watching this online service in your pajamas. I can see some of you. Yep, put your hands up, hide under your pillows or your dressing gowns as much as you want, but I know it's true. I know. I can see you. Yep, there. Yep. Anyway, I just decided you guys couldn't have all the fun. I needed to be able to join you and wear my pajamas to church today.
I know that you are all waiting on the edge of your seats to find out who won the Bubble Olympics. Oh my goodness, here is a treat for you today. Watch this clip and congratulations to our winners.
Please give us your names.
I am Freestyle Freddy and I swim for the COVID-19 champions.
Hi, my name is Backstroke Benny, and I will be swimming for the Corona National Champions.
And what are we doing today?
We are doing a competition of all swimming strokes.
Fantastic. For time.
In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go!
Swim, Johnny!
So I don't know about you, but sometimes during lockdown, I've found it a little bit tricky. There are times when everything is happening all at once and it's a little bit, and yes, that's a thing. And there are times during those times when I don't necessarily use my words that well. Sometimes my words come out a little bit harder than they should. They don't come out that soft. And if during our pillow fight before I was to throw a brick in my pillow and smack somebody over the head with it, then that would hurt. That wouldn't be good. That would not end well. It would actually kill them. Proverbs 18 verse 21 says, words kill or words give life. They are poison or they are fruit. You choose. Now, you might listen to that and go, fruit is poison. Yep, okay, I understand that some of you would feel that way. But imagine that instead that it says chocolate. Imagine that it says ice cream. Imagine that it says your favorite thing inserted in that gap. They are poison or they are your favorite thing, the best thing, an incredible thing that you really love. Words can be like that. They can be poison, they can be horrible, they can be hurtful, or they can be amazing and they can be loving and kind. And I guess as we go into lockdown for a little bit longer, what I wanted just to help us remember this week, and me, is that we can choose our words. We can choose to let them be gentle. We can choose to let them be soft-hitting. They don't have to be hard-hitting. They can be kind. They can be loving. They can be words that are like fruit or chocolate or chippies or ice cream. They can be good things. So this week, if you start to feel a little bit for any reason, because of your schoolwork, because of your siblings, because of something, just remember that your words can be poison or they can be awesome. Why don't you let them be awesome this week? Bless you guys.
Earlier this week, I received a phone call from my uncle who lives in Mount Maunganui. He was just checking in and asking how we were going as a family. And towards the end of the phone call, he expressed that he understood that I might have some, or we might have some fears and anxiety as we're expecting a baby while this COVID-19 situation is happening. And he closed the phone call by saying that he would take those fears and anxieties and carry them for me for a while to give me a bit of a break. And I really loved the generosity of that and the peace that that sort of placed over me, not having to carry those fears during this time.
Yeah, so we'd encourage you to, if you've got the opportunity to take some worries off other people, do that. You'll be a real blessing to them. We're going to head into worship now with Tim, and that's a favourite time for us as a family. Isla gets to dance around and we really enjoy it. So sing at the top of your lungs in your lounge or your bedroom, wherever you're at, and I'll just pray as we do that. God, we thank you for the opportunity to sing, to worship, to honour you, and we do that again this morning, Lord, with all that's within us. Lord, we sing and we praise your holy name. Thank you, God.
Stand in awe for me. Kāpiti Impact family, it's great to be with you this morning and to be able to share in this online format just some of what God has been speaking to me about in this last few weeks. And I really want to share something with you around the word shalom. Many of you will have heard that word before. I think it's often commonly described as a word that means peace or the absence of conflict or war. But if we actually look in the Hebrew, it means so much more. And it comes from the root word of shalom, which means to be safe in mind, in body, and in estate. So it's speaking of a completeness or a type of wholeness, which encourages us to live generously and to be able to give back and share. And the word that comes to mind when I think about that is being someone who can live from a place of overflow. So today, when we would look at the biblical references, it's often using shalom in terms of meaning this inner completeness and tranquility. And so if you were to greet someone in Israel today and say shalom, you would literally be saying, may you be full of well-being, or may health and prosperity be upon you. So this is a picture of a soul that is very still and present, and where we have this inner completeness and tranquility that allows us to thrive and prosper regardless of the world that is around us. And what I want to explore with you today is how we can journey towards experiencing greater freedom and to the point where we are people who are full of well-being and we're able to live generous lives which overflow to the people we come in contact with. And to illustrate this, I want to share like a compilation of different Bible stories. So this is basically like an Instagram version of Genesis and Exodus. And I want to look first of all at the picture of in the garden where God has created Adam and Eve, and he blesses them and he tells them to go forward and be fruitful and to multiply and to subdue the earth. But then we have another picture, which is where they choose to walk away from trusting in God, and the result means that their life is suddenly a lot harder and it becomes more difficult for them to achieve the purposes and plans he had for them. We then move on, skip forward many generations to where we find Abraham and a picture of Abraham as a man who trusted God, and this was credited to him as righteousness. And God blessed him and said he would have descendants more numerous than the grains of sand on the beach. And he would cause him to be fruitful and multiply, and that they would become, his descendants would become a thriving nation. And this was to show everyone who saw them, it would be to give them a picture of what life could be like if they were to put their trust in God. And we skip then to years later where Abraham's descendants are now living in Egypt. They still carry the blessing and they're still increasing in number and thriving. But this is so much so that the king of the Egypt sees the Israelites as a threat, and he decides that they could potentially outnumber the Egyptians and have the ability to defeat and overthrow them. So he decides he'll prevent this by placing a taskmaster over them. And the role of the taskmaster was to oppress them with hard labor and make them work in the fields doing manual labor, and they had to make bricks and mortar. But it was interesting that the more the Egyptians oppressed them, I think in Exodus 1 verse 12, it says, the more the Egyptians oppressed them, the more they multiplied and expanded. So the Egyptians dreaded and were exasperated by the Israelites. And so this pattern continues for a number of years to where we have Moses and a picture of him where he has been tasked with going to Pharaoh and basically telling him that he had to let God's people go. And of course, Pharaoh was furious. He didn't want to let his workforce go off into the desert. So he told the taskmasters to make the Israelites work even harder, and they now had to find their own straw in order to make the bricks and mortar, but they still had to produce the same number each day, so there was no let up on the quota that was needed. And again in Exodus 5 verse 9, it says, labor be heavier on men, and let them work hard, so they will pay no attention to their God's words. So this is a picture of taskmasters forcing someone to be busier and busier so they can't hear what God is saying. And we also see pictures of God offering blessing and freedom, and people making decisions which result in that being replaced by a taskmaster. It's also a picture of an oppressor forcing someone to work harder and harder for the same results. And a picture of an oppressor trying to restrict the blessing of God and the divine calling to be fruitful, restricting that being manifest in someone's life. So today, we don't tend to have a physical guard standing over ready to whip us if we don't produce our quota of bricks. But we carry a number of different roles. We may have an employer, a partner, a family, and all of those come with expectations of time and energy that is needed to support those roles. We also are bombarded with messages from the media and other people about what we should be doing in order to be successful in this world. And then we also have our internal taskmasters, the ones who mentally and emotionally are whipping us because we haven't achieved what our culture says is the things we need to do in order to be successful and fulfilled. And I look at that and contrast that with what Jesus said in Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30, where he says, "Are you tired and worn out? Are you burnt out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you will recover your life. Watch how I do it. Sorry, work with me and walk with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace, and I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you will learn to live freely and lightly." So what Jesus is saying, that we need to spend time with him as his apprentice to learn how to live a different life to the one our cultures has taught us to live. And if we were to now examine what our life looks like, we can see that it's made up of a number of different components which all compete for our time and our energy and our attention. And as we add more things in, we can just end up juggling and trying to keep all the balls in the air. And so we live a life that has become hurried and reactive instead of fruitful and proactive. We live in a culture where we're surrounded by opportunities for digital distractions, and companies spend billions of dollars competing for our time and our attention in that arena. But the problem with all of these distractions is that they actually limit our ability to hear God's voice. So it's like having a phone call which has a lot of static on it. So you know that there is someone on the other end trying to talk to you, but you just can't hear a word that they're saying. And so for many of us, we know God's there, but we can't hear what he's saying to us on a daily basis. And one of the things that I have personally enjoyed about this lockdown period is that it has forced me to simplify my life and to have the opportunity to examine what things move me towards shalom and what things move me away from it. And if I reflect, I think many of the moments in my life that I wouldn't want appearing on Instagram or Facebook, these have come out of times where I have been overcommitted, overtired, and working under pressure in order to accomplish everything that I have decided I needed to. And I came across this quote about a week ago, which is from someone called John Ortberg. And he said, "Hurry is not the sign of a disordered schedule, but the sign of a disordered life." And then there was another quote from someone called Edward Freeman, and this is from a leadership book where he describes a quality of a leader is that of being someone who carries a non-anxious presence. And so if you think we are called to be salt and light, in this world, and we're called to live from a place where we are hearing God's voice, where we are trusting in Him, and where we are resting in shalom. And when we do this, we carry this non-anxious presence where we can be seen as leaders that bring the kingdom of heaven into the world, where we are able to point to Jesus who makes all of this possible, and to Jesus who is the Prince of Peace. And so some of the questions I've reflected on in this time and I want to pose to you right now is, what do I need to remove from my life in order to make room for the kingdom of heaven to reside in me and to have a soul which is thriving and complete? And then the other question is, what do I now need to include in my life in order to move towards this? And I thought of a couple of examples to illustrate what I was trying to talk about was, Glenn is a very keen gardener, and he will often see a plant that looks to be struggling a bit. So he will dig it out and he will move it to another part of the garden where it has a better environment and it gets everything it needs to flourish. And then also he will see a plant that is perhaps, it's in the right spot, but it's being choked by some other plants around it. So he will remove all of those and just make room for it to grow to its full size and potential. But in that, I think it's important to note that the plants that are restricting its growth, they're not necessarily bad. They're just competing for space and for nutrients. And so you might have some things in your life that are not necessarily bad, but they're just competing for your time and your energy and your attention. So as we get ready to leave this lockdown experience, let's just take a fresh look at what we would like our post-lockdown life to look like. And I wanted to leave you with some practical exercises and tips that you could do at home and will hopefully be helpful in moving you closer to having a life which is built on shalom and a life where your soul is complete and you experience tranquility. So the first one is about a garage sale. So if you can imagine you are going to have a garage sale of your life, I want you to grab pens and paper or post-it notes, and on each individual piece of paper, write down everything that makes up your life, everything that you put time and energy into, whether it's cooking or the different roles you're involved in, and Facebook, all of those things, watching Netflix. Just write them all down and then spread them all out on the table or stick them on a wall and just ask God to show you which are the ones that need to stay and are going to help you flourish and which are the ones that do need to go in the garage sale of life. And then the other exercise I had was, imagine you were going on a long journey with a specific destination and you can only take with you one suitcase. And so with that, you will need to first prioritize what will go in the suitcase because you only have so much room. And then only when you've got your priorities in there can you actually look at what space is left over to be able to fit other things in. So that's a couple of exercises for you. And then I wanted to share with you some tips that I have found helpful and things that I can see move me towards Kingdom of Heaven living and move me towards shalom. And the number one thing is to, first of all, find some space to have a quiet time with God each day, and that is without distractions. and it can be hard to do. You might only be able to manage 5 minutes before all the kids hit the deck and start demanding breakfast and things like that. But we really need this time. And so the other thing was to be aware of the things that consume our time but don't produce any fruit. And then be willing to take a look at all of the distractions we have in our life. And if is it something that we can eliminate and make room for shalom? And that's going to be different for everyone. And I think it's important that you all hear from God yourself about what he is putting the finger on, and you respond to that. But as we get ready to leave this lockdown, I think it would be great if we were a people who come out of it having an increased capacity to experience shalom in our own life, but also carry it with us into all the different environments we enter, and that we can be a people who are leaders that people look to as they start to navigate what this new normal is going to look like. And I think that's just something to aim for. I want to leave you there and say enjoy this day. Pick up your pens and post-it notes and start decluttering your life. And grace and peace, everyone.
Thanks, Debbie. Those are some great thoughts, some great things to think over and chew over in the coming week.
Thanks for joining us this morning, family. Don't forget to connect with each other on the different platforms that we've talked about today.
Yeah, and just as we close, I'd like to give a benediction. It's a Franciscan benediction. Hopefully this is a blessing to you as we go and move off into our weeks. So may God bless us with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths and superficial relationships so that we may live deep within our hearts. May God bless us with anger at injustice, oppression and exploitation of people so that we may work for justice, freedom and peace. May God bless us with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, and starvation, so that we may reach out our hands to comfort them and turn their pain into joy. And may God bless us with enough foolishness to believe that we can make a difference in this world, so that we can do what others claim cannot be done. Go well this week. Grace and peace. Celebrate.